he should be. You know, yes. And I was very lucky to know him, and yes. I absolutely treasure everything that he taught me, really. Yeah. I knew him in the last, I would say, 10, 15 years of his life.
Yes.
And he's a very, very wise man.
It's incredible, because when we hear about him, and we know, of course, about the, you know, we know about him because of the Museum of Witchcraft and all of the other things that he did, but it's incredible to meet somebody that actually was in contact with Cecil Williamson. Ladies and gentlemen, we're talking with Levannah Morgan, the author of A Witch's Mirror, The Art of Making Magic, and hello.
Hello.
We were talking about Cecil Williamson, which was one of your teachers, and you said that you met him for the last 10 to 15 years of his life. What was the most important thing that you think that he actually taught you that you would single out? I know that it's very difficult to do, but...
Well, I think what I would single out is that Cecil was the best worker with spirits that I've ever come across, that, and he had something that he called learning to speak the language of silence, and a way of communicating with spirits very, very powerfully and very quietly, alone at night in one's working places, often out in the woods and the moors of the southwest of England, where he lived and where I live. And I would single that out as the most important thing that he taught me, because I think it's at the heart of true witchcraft.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And we're going to talk a little bit about this, the spirits and, you know, spirit jars, mm-hmm. spirit houses. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're going to talk about all of this. A Witch's Mirror, The Art of Making Magic. I noticed that you didn't use the customary magic as M-A-G-I-C-K, which is, you know, normally people say that because, you know, it comes from Crowley, and mm-hmm. it's distinguishing magic from stage magic, etc. Why did you use magic
well,
without a K?
I think in Britain, when you spell magic with a CK, mm-hmm. it tends to refer a bit specifically to the kind of ritual magic as practiced by Crowley and his many admirable descendants.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not used quite so much in relation to traditional witchcraft, which is what I'm really interested in.
Mm-hmm.
So it has that magic without the K, has that other connotation here in the UK. So I kind of stuck with what I know.
Let's talk about Lee Noble. How wonderful are the illustrations? Are there amazing illustrations in this book?
Yes, he's a tremendous artist. He's a tremendous Ooh. Magical artist, and I was very, very lucky to
Absolutely.
Have him collaborate with
yeah,
me.
Very, very beautiful. I mean, really.
Thank you. I'm sure he'd be thrilled to know that.
Oh, yes. And we love it. And we have to thank Apple Band Publishing, mm-hmm. because they are very, very generous to send us the review copies. Thank you so much, John and Julia and yeah. All of those generous people that, you know, sent us the copies and all of that.
Yeah.
Very beautiful
and
book. It's oh,
And
sorry.
You know they've been going for 20 years now.
Yes, I know. They just,
and
the
you know, the job they've done for witchcraft and paganism in that time, the breadth of the range of writers they've published is absolutely phenomenal. They're great people.
Yes,
and delightful to work with, I have to say.
We will have them both in the show to talk about Capelban and its history. It's very, very nice. So, a little book, as you say, very interesting. You say little book, but of little has nothing but the size, because it is really a very, very powerful book. It has very, very good and wonderful advice for every practitioner of magic, not only traditional witchcraft, but other paths also. Now, one of the things that I really like about this book is that you do say, please try this at home.
Absolutely. I mean, my form of witchcraft is nothing if not experiential, and I really want people to go out and try the things in this book, but not only that, but to use it as a source of inspiration, I hope, for making their own ways of making things and doing things, because I think some of the best and the deepest magic is intensely practical. We tend to be, I think, a little bit wordy about our magic. And we think if we're saying things, it must be right. But I'm much more about doing things, and I hope that that comes across.
Now, you know, getting away from a little bit of the teachings, and of course, you know, teachings are very important. How important it is to work with your own intuition and to know the right way in the right time and when things arise, you know, when necessity arises, how much intuitive decisions and spell making goes into things without even knowing what to do. You just come up with the ingredients and you know exactly what it is and you know how to put things. How much of this is part of traditional witchcraft and what you do?
Well, in terms of what I do, it's a huge part of what I do, and it is about intuition, but I would say that that intuition is guided all the time by working with spirits. You know, one can decide to do something, I don't know, to work a spell, to make an object, produce a charm. And I always ask the spirits before I do it, and that's what gives me the confidence, that's what makes me know I'm on the right track. And I would commend that approach to your listeners, really. It's always, always, always guided by spirits.
So they do whisper in your ear.
They do whisper in your ear, and they'll also show you things.
Yes, yeah. Now that takes us to the familiar spirit. You bought once a knife.
That's involved Cecil Williamson too.
Yes, yes. So you bought a knife, and suddenly you thought, "Oh, I can't put this knife down. I have to take it with me, right?" And you took it with you to your house. You know, put it gently on the table, and you heard this noise, right? And the knife was on the floor on the other side of the
in the middle of the night.
Yes. Can you continue this story for me?
Yes, yes. It wasn't at all a knife that I wanted to buy, but when I picked it up, it got me. There was no going back from that. So, yes, brought it home, wanted to find out more about it, but I was quite in awe of it, quite nervous about it. So I left it downstairs in my cottage. I went to bed, and then I heard this crash at about, I think it was 2:30 in the morning, and I got up and went downstairs wondering what was going on, you know, whether some interesting form of wildlife had got into the house, which does happen around here. And no, the knife was not where I'd left it. I'd left it on the shelf, and it was on the floor and on the other side of the room. And I looked, and all the doors were closed, there were no windows open, there was nobody in the house, there was no way it could have got there. So I thought, aha, it's trying to tell me, and I think it's trying to tell me that it's not happy. And this was some years ago now, and I consulted with Cecil about it. I said, what do I do? And he said, well, you must let this knife talk to you through its spirits and through the spirits that you commune with. So what I did was I put it under my pillow beside me when I slept, and in a series of dreams it let me know exactly its history, and its history was very, very unhappy. And Cecil and I talked a bit about this, and we decided that, you know, what it wanted to was to do was firstly tell its story, which it had begun to do, and then it wanted to be accepted and somehow made happy again. So I told it my spirit name, my witch name, which is an important part in any exchange with a spirit or with something that has a spirit within it, and it told me its name, and it told me its whole history. And gradually we became very good friends, and it's now one of my most treasured working tools.
Now, how important is this? I mean, if you don't do that, does the tool work, or is it about the tool working, or is it about the help of the spirit so that the tool will serve you? How does that relationship go?
Well, I think in that specific case, it was quite clear, really, because from the moment when it threw itself onto the floor, in a very, you know, dramatic bid to attract my attention, it was clear that there was a spirit already in it, and the task was to work with that spirit. And if you make your own witch's tools, say you go to the woods and you choose a tree and a piece of wood to make a wand or a staff with, there will already be a spirit there in the tree, and you can invite that home to work with you. But the process of, in all cases, the process of either contacting the spirit or inviting the spirit in is absolutely crucial to the working. You probably gathered from the book that I do encourage people very strongly to make their own working tools rather than buying them. Mm-hmm. Because if you do that, you will imbue the thing with your own energy and make a terrific contact with the spirit that's in it. Or if you feel it has no spirit in it, depends what it is, that spirit that you want to invite into it.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a power about that that I really don't think is there if you just buy something that somebody has made. I mean, beautiful and lovely in ceremonies, those things are, you know.
Yeah.
I would always go for the making your own approach because of that very direct contact that you can have with the spirits.
Yes, yeah. Now, the one of the things that I found it very interesting is this exchange of name, which is, you know, if you want to have a friend, you have to tell your name, right?
Exactly.
You know, that's to me. But then, you know, talking about spirits, and you talked about something that it's very interesting, which is pixie-led.
Yes.
Which it, you know, happens everywhere.
Yes.
There is always some kind of spirit that will do this, that will actually be, you know, either be in Portugal, Spain, wherever you go, there is always some kind of pixie going on.
Yes,
activity.
The spirits of the land.
That's right. And, you know, the Romans knew that also because they were very respectful. And you can see little stones here and there in very local villages, and they say actually, you know, Jenny Lockeye and things like that. So that they would pay homage to the spirit of the land because that's, you know, they knew what they were doing. You got lost where you are. Lost because they do, and that is another teacher that you had.
This is an occasion you are referring to when I was out on Dartmoor. I don't know how you know well the people listening to us will know, but Dartmoor is a very wild moorland area in Devon in the southwest of England. It's land that's been over the centuries largely left to its own devices, apart from quite low level farming and in some places a bit of mining, and I think that places like that have spirits in them which are extremely powerful, and of course the place belongs to them. It doesn't belong to you. If you go there, you're encroaching on their territory, and you have to treat them with respect, you know, just as I would expect you to treat my house with respect if you walked into it. And so yes, we were there. It was Hereward, myself and members of Hereward's Coven, and we were going to a place called Skorrell Stone Circle. It's an old Stone Age circle on the northern part of Dartmoor, and we used to go there to work quite a lot. Incidentally, there's the most marvellous initiation place there called the Tolman, which is a hold stone, a huge glacial boulder built into the side of a riverbank with a big hole in it. It's about 10 feet tall, and it's an old Devon initiation rite that you have to climb 3 times through this stone. It's quite a perilous business. So it is one of our favourite working places. We knew it very well. We went there all the time, and we walked over the brow of a broad hill to the stone circle. We did the work that we wanted to do, and then we came to go back. And we knew the way back really, really well. It was really straightforward. It was a path straight over the hill. Back to where we'd set out from, but we couldn't find it, and everything was sort of disappearing into a funny haze. It wasn't a fog, you know, fogs and mists come down there quite easily, as you can imagine, but it was just that we couldn't see anything. And Hereward, who knew these ways really well, said, I know what's happening, we're being pixie-led. And pixie-led is the Devon word for being led astray and messed about with, played games with by the local spirits. And there's a time-honored remedy for this, which is mentioned in a lot of the accounts of Devon folklore and what the cunning men and women did. And he said, "What? It's really simple. What we have to do is stop and turn our clothes inside out. And I commend this to you." So we stopped. We took off our coats, turned them inside out, put them on again, and said thank you to the pixies. And there was the path in front of us, just where it should have been in the first place. We were able to walk straight back. And so, you know, a very good lesson in honouring and respecting the spirits. And you know, there's another idea around here, which I'm sure there is where you are, that there are some places where the spirits really don't want you to go. And if they don't want you to go, you don't get silly or foolhardy about it. You just do what they want. You go somewhere else.
That's right. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. Now, you said also, you know, you can have little guys with red hood, you know, hoods and in your garden. But when you find one in the wild, you know.
Absolutely. They're not the same thing. I mean, our poor old pixies, you know, have been somewhat traduced by popular culture. So there are places that are called pixie sanctuaries for tourists to go to, you know, where you can buy a little model one or one to put in your garden, and they're very jolly little chaps with red hats and green coats and nice little beard and maybe fishing rods or something. But, you know, that's a sweet little fairy tale version of what they really are. They're extremely strong-willed spirit people in their own place, and they live by their own rules, not yours. And if you're going to work there, you better learn what their rules are and go with them too. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Otherwise, being pixie-led will probably be the least of your troubles. They have a very strong tradition of helping people who help them.
Oh, yes.
But they also, there are also plenty of records of them really upsetting, discombobulating, and generally doing damage to people who don't offer them respect.
Yes, Ladies and gentlemen, Levannah Morgan, we're talking with Levannah Morgan, the author of A Witch's Mirror, The Art of Making Magic. Little book, she says, but I think it is a big book.
Well, you can get it in your pocket quite easily.
Yes, it's true, but yeah. It's really quite not the size, is it? It's the contents that matter. Now, we talk about spirits. How important is spirits in this tradition and what you do? Not only, you know, you say that there is spirits everywhere, everything has spirits, including your tools, you know, objects have these spirits, and then we talked about pixies and all of that. Now, it's quite interesting, because, you know, you talk about also, and this, you said, you know, Cecil Williamson actually taught you working with spirits and all of that. This goes everywhere. This goes into scrying, for instance, and you talk about that, and you talk about summoning spirits into a mirror. So there is a very strong connection between, you know, why do you think that people are people? Do you really think, I mean, what is your opinion about this in terms of what other people are doing? I mean, why aren't they actually doing this true contact and you know, connection between them and the spirits? Are they afraid? Do you think that people are afraid of this contact?
I think a lot of people are quite afraid of it. But I have to say, I think it's becoming more widespread now. I also think that a lot of people from then, I suppose the 1960s onwards, who learnt about and practiced Wicca, didn't include it within what they did, which is quite crazy, because it actually is a part, you know, if you meet people who practice Wicca very deeply, it absolutely is a part of what they do. But I think it somehow got edited out of that version of witchcraft a little bit. And now we've seen over the last 10 years or so, through all sorts of people's very good work. I mean, I'd mentioned Steve Patterson and Gemma Gary, particularly, and the wonderful Mike Howard, who edits the Cauldron magazine.
Yes.
The knowledge of this is becoming more widespread. I think a lot of people simply didn't know about it. Yes. I think some people are afraid to do it. And to be sure, you have to learn how to do it properly. You don't just kind of rush into it without learning what you're doing and taking obvious precautions. But I think it is becoming more widespread. But I think there's also a strand of people who kind of aren't interested in it. You know, they just want to worship pagan gods, and that's all very well and good. And I'm glad they do it. And you know, it's very very happy and fulfilling thing for them to do. But it's not. To me, it's not the sort of the deepest and most practical form of witchcraft.
Which is what you are interested in, really?
I think that working with spirits is, if you look at all the witchcraft traditions all over the world, and you know, all the other traditional practices in African and diaspora traditional witchcraft, Native American practices, it tends to be at the heart of traditional spiritualities. And I think that our form of witchcraft has that in common with all those things, although it's expressed very differently sometimes.
Now, we talked about spirits all the way, and this is, you know, for our listeners, you know, this is really a commonality that go really across the board on this practice. And it's just, you know, you can talk about divination, you can talk about you know, objects and tools, and there is always a spirit there. Now, the other thing that I'm really interested to talk to you about is the Devon spirit jar, which is basically
it's very
interesting, because it is. And then again, Cecil Williamson comes here, you know, as your teacher, and taught you about this. What really is a spirit jar, and why do we do one?
Okay, and just also to say that if you are fortunate enough to be able to visit the Museum of Witchcraft at Boss Castle in Cornwall, you can see Cecil's beautiful spirit jar there. And as I think almost all of their collection is viewable online, you can also go on their website and look at it there. And you know, they are a tremendous place, and really anyone who's interested in this should go and have a look, either at the website or in person. So a spirit jar. Now, for most people, their home is the centre of their magic. Yes, we work outdoors, but an awful lot of what we do in our homes. And so you want to have places in your home where you can be in regular contact with the spirits. And the idea of a spirit jar is that it's a place where the spirits that you like to work with, and the spirits that protect your home, can rest. Somebody said to me, yes, but are they trapped in there if you make it? Well, obviously not, because that would be a terrible thing to do. And then secondly, I think the kind of spirits I'm working with could not be bound by a glass jar. But the idea, this is how you make one, is that you take a large glass jar. It can be anything. I used an old big jar from a sweet shop, I guess dating back to about the 1920s, but it can be anything. And you make sure it's very nice and clean and dry, and it needs to have a lid so you can seal it up. And then basically what you do is you put into it things that the spirits will like, that will attract them to the jar. What Cecil did, what he taught me, was that the spirits would like things like small seashells, white pebbles, ears of dried corn, bits of red thread, a couple of small bits of mirror, nice things like that. Nothing that will decay or rot, just things that are nicely dried, maybe a few herbs. And you fill the jar probably about between, I would have said, an eighth and a sixth of its level with those things. And you also use your own intuition and be guided a bit. So you put into it things that you think are important. And so you put this stuff in the jar, and then you seal the jar, and you invite the spirits to come and rest in there and work with you. And you regularly acknowledge the jar. I say good morning to mine every day, to the spirits in there. You keep it in a nice place. This is not something that you have to hide away, but also I think you probably don't don't put it on the mantelpiece and proudly show it off to, you know, the man who comes to read your electricity meter or anything like that.
Yes.
But you don't hide it away, and you give it a nice place where it feels cherished, and you keep it very clean, and you look after it. And there you are, you know, that's a spirit jar. And I've noticed, it's not just a spirit jar alone, but that people who come to my house who don't know anything about witchcraft and don't know that I do it, saying, your house has a nice, warm, positive feeling. And I just think, yes, aha, well, of course it has. Because here are these lovely spirits in this jar and in other places looking after me. And it's a wonderful thing to make. And please try this.
Yes, yes. Please do it at home.
Please, absolutely do it at home.
And the book will tell you how to do it very, very detailed.
The book will tell you how to do it. But, you know, as with everything, I suppose my book is quite like a recipe book.
It is.
You know, and with all good recipe books, you know how it works. You try something and you make it exactly as the writer says. And you think, oh, I like that. And then you think, well, what would happen if I just added a little bit more of this spice, you know, or something? And you start to experiment. So I really hope people will use it like that. And yes, they'll kind of follow the general guidelines I've laid down, but their own creativity and intuition will come into play as well.
And then
they will make lovely discoveries, really.
You want to inspire, right?
Exactly.
That's right.
Yeah. I don't want to dictate.
Yes, that's true. Now, I have read a lot of recipes for the Witche's bottles, and I'm guessing that this would change depending on the place that you're finding one. Some of them are made of, I've heard them made of glass, I've heard them made of clay. I mean, there's all sorts of things. The book, A Witch's Mirror, The Art of Making Magic, will tell you how to do a little bit of history of it, and then it will tell you. Yes.
It will.
But what is the mechanics in here? I mean, what is happening on a witch's bottle?
Well, there are a couple of different kinds which I write about, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, historically, we know, because there are lots and lots of accounts of them and lots of them have been found, what they used to do was to lift the effects of bad magic. So if you went, I'm sure the same in the US, you know, if in this country in the 18th or 19th century, you felt you were being bewitched, something was wrong, or there was an illness that wouldn't go away, you know, all those classic things where you felt you were under the influence of malign magic, your local cunning man or woman would tell you to make a witch bottle to get rid of it. And historically, they were quite specific. You put lots of sharp metal objects, nails, pins, needles, in a bottle, in a glass bottle, or a clay bottle. They used both. I think, to be honest, in former times, people used whatever they had to hand, you know.
Yes.
And you filled the bottle up with your own urine, and then you put it in your chimney place, as near your fire as you could put it without it breaking. And the idea historically was that as it heated up, it would cause pain to the person who'd done the bewitching, and they would lift their curse, their magic. So that's very specific, isn't it?
You can
still do that if you feel so afflicted. But mainly, I've talked about using witch bottles for protection.
Yes.
And to attract good things.
Mm-hmm.
And so the witch bottle for protection is a bit like the witch bottle for getting rid of bad magic, with a few significant differences. I put pins in there, lots of pins, some salt, and whichever herbs I think I want to use at the time. Rosemary is a particular favorite in this connection. And for protection, I don't fill it up with urine. I fill it up with red wine or red wine vinegar. And then that goes in a very quiet, secret place where people won't see it,
mm-hmm.
and works its magic very quietly. If you have an open fire in a chimney place, hiding it away in the chimney is a really good place to put it,
mm-hmm.
bearing in mind that traditionally the chimney is the place where spirits come into the home and go out again. If you haven't got a chimney, you can put it in the cupboard under the sink, or under the stairs. But it's just generally somewhere where not just people coming into the house, but you are going to forget about it. So you take no notice of it whatsoever once it's been put there and set in motion, as it were. And you, if you move house, you never take it with you, because you can make another one. You know, wherever you're going to, you must leave it where it is. So, you know, that's a variation of witch bottles for protection. But you can also, I've made them for health and prosperity. And in that case, there's actually no liquid in the bottle. What I do is pins, I like the pins, and salt, put in layers, alternated with herbs and various other plant materials, all dried so that they don't rot. So if I was making one for someone who had been really unwell and their house didn't feel good and they just generally wanted a bit more nice, hot, positive energy in their life, I would do the pins and the salt, and then I would put lovely bright red things like chilies and marigold petals and red rose petals, all in layers, a bit like one of those old-fashioned bottles of different coloured sand. Stopper it up tightly, seal it with nice red wax, and there you go.
Very good.
And you can adapt this, obviously, to your own purposes.
Of course, of course.
And now, you can still pee in a bottle if you feel so inclined.
Pee in a bottle, and, you know, it's just... Now, the other thing that... It's very interesting that you're saying that, you know, near the fire, because I knew one very old spell that was to know who is gossiping, you know, and you would throw red, it would be red dust made of anything, it doesn't matter what it is, if it is a plant that it's red, whatever it is, you know, you just macerate it into a dust and you throw it into your fire, either the hearth or whatever it is, and you ask the question, who is saying this about me? And next morning or next day or in a couple of few days, you will come across the person, and the person will have red spots in their skin.
You will know.
So it is you, huh?
Who was saying? Yes.
So that was one of the only things that I know about. You know, close to fire or fire. There's definitely a lot of
A huge number of traditional magics that involve working with the fire. And if you think about it, it's very logical, because you know, fire has been our companion since we first sort of became human, hasn't it? The use of fire, as my friend Julian Vane always tells me, that it's one of the defining characteristics of being human. And so we sat and gazed into fires and used them for divination and recognized them as places where we can talk to the spirit world for a very, very long time. And there is also this idea that the hearth, the chimney, is the place where spirits come into and leave the home. I think we see that, you know, in the old myths of Father Christmas, don't we? Santa Claus, a remnant of that. But if you look at many of the engravings of witches flying to the Sabbat, you know, from the late medieval, early modern times, I'll show the witches flying up the chimney.
That's true. Now, what do you think that you know, we see all of these things, you know, we know that artists are sometimes, you know, inspired. It's not that they have seen it, but they have either heard about it or they have been inspired by, you know, divine powers or something. And, you know, and then they will represent things. Do you think that these depictions that we see sometimes in books of, you know, here and there, of the witch's Sabbath and them flying through the air and all of that, how would that translate to practicality on the practices that we know today or that we knew in the past?
That's a huge question. Do you mean, you know, do we think that we flew to the Sabbath? I think there's a lot of different thinking and opinions about that, and interestingly there's quite a few academic writers looking at this at the moment, and I think one of the quite persuasive arguments is that these are descriptions of what we might call shamanic activities. The idea of the spirit flight, the flying to join the spirits, is present in many traditions all over the world, in many shamanic traditions as well as witchcraft traditions. Mm-hmm. There's a wonderful writer called Emma Wilby, who has written a huge, exhaustive book about the trial and confessions of Isabel Gowdy, and she sort of noted down all the records about going to the Sabbath that she could find from everywhere. And she points out that most of them say quite specifically that the person left their body in bed at the time, or they left a broomstick in bed to be their body. And I kind of like the idea that we went there in the spirit world, because that's what I do. You know, I travel in the spirit world, so I respond to that idea quite well. But I don't have the one answer. I don't think any of us ever will.
Yes, that's true. Well, I was talking with somebody in the other day, one of our guests, and he actually mentioned a series that is now on television called Salem, and it's a TV series, and mm-hmm. and they based it in the trials, of course, of 1692 yeah. in Salem, Massachusetts, the pioneers and everything, and the Puritans. But it contains a lot of these ideas of the Sabbath mm-hmm. being in the spirit. You just go with your spirit. You just astral mm-hmm. travel, whatever you want to call it. I just wanted to know about, you know, what we thought about that. And that's,
well, yeah. I think so. I mean, I can't know
we can't,
very well
really.
What, you know,
yeah,
what people
yeah.
did in the 16th and 17th century.
Yeah.
I know that I go in the flesh, in the person, as it were, to witch gatherings and coven meetings and the like, you know, quite normally, without the, you know, the aid of anything more than my legs or a car if it's a long way.
Mm-hmm.
But I, you know, I have no way of knowing exactly what people were doing in the 16th and 17th century. But it's my best guess that it was spirit travel, because yes. there are just so many accounts of it.
Absolutely, yes, that's yeah. right. Yeah, yeah. Now, how, you know, I know that you live in the southwest of England. I know
that's
that you
right.
live in Devon, Cornwall. But you know, looking around at all of this, I mean, and you wrote the book because, you know, obviously these are very important things to you, and you know that, you know, you need to communicate this with people so that people can find it
yeah.
and then inspire them to actually do their own magic. But how disconnected are we, you know, from all of this? I mean, I know that you live in you know, as you say, in the middle of nowhere, being somewhere, but... how do you, looking at all of these, and I'm sure that you look at other, you know, these neo-pagan movements, these, all of these gatherings and things like that, but how disconnected are we from nature? Because all of these things, sometimes they're held, you know, inside, indoors, you
mm-hmm.
know, cities and things like that. How would you compensate for that if you live in a city, for
well,
instance? You know,
we live where we live, you know, and...
Yes.
My way is what I do, but I haven't got the right to tell anyone else if it's what they should do. And I know that it's just as possible to work this magic and work with the spirits in the middle of big cities, because I know people who do it very,
mm-hmm.
very well.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
I would never say to anyone, look, you have to
move
and go and live in the countryside in order to do this work. You don't. And... all sorts of people practice all sorts of magic, and I think the important thing is to find out, make contact with the spirits where you are, and do it where you are, whether that be, I don't know, you know, in the middle of Bristol or London or San Francisco, or whether it be in the kind of place where I live. And I don't actually, you know, I've described my practices because they're what I've done, but I don't claim my way of being superior at all. But I think on one level you're right that a lot of people are incredibly disconnected from this world. But then if you're a witch, or you're learning about the craft, or it's what you aspire to, then you've already said to the spirit world, haven't you, that you want that contact, and that contact will come.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, absolutely. No, you just have to be aware. You know, consciousness of what you have around you. And you know, sometimes you just you don't see it because you're just so intertwined with all of this. You know, the other thing that
I tell you as well that one of the best witches I know and workers with spirits is an old lady in her late 80s, and she has not been able to leave one room because of health issues for the last 15 years. She never goes out. A lot of the time she has to stay in her bed, but she's the most phenomenal worker of magic. And so, you know, what does that tell us? It's you and what you do, not where you are.
Absolutely, yes. Yeah, yeah. Now, you said also that now taking this into a location, seashore, is very much, you know, disregarded as a magical place, and it is a liminal place, and you know, and you talk about this very often because, you know, where you are also, you do work in or very, very close to sea. And of course, this is part of your practice also. You talk about objects and sacred things that you can actually gather, you know, from the beach and all of that. If you would give us an example of something that you can actually gather and that would be used to... One of the things that really comes to mind to me, it was this fantastic story that you talked about, the driftwood bull rower, or the spiritual caller. I would like you to explain a little bit about how do you you can do it, but how do you use it?
Okay, well, a bull roarer, I think I'm right in saying that was an African term for it, though that may not, I'm not entirely sure about that. Or as I would call it more, I suppose, a spirit caller is a very flat, thin, sort of oval-shaped piece of wood, maybe about 6 to 8 inches long, and it's very thin. It's as thin as you can make it while it's still so solid, really. And it has a hole in one end to which you very securely attach a long cord, about 12 feet long. I use a leather thread, and you have to tie it extremely securely, otherwise serious injury could result. And you, it's used to sanctify an outdoor working space and call the spirits. And you hold the cord. You hold the end of the cord in one hand, and then you hold it a bit further down in your other hand, so it's between your two hands, but the main length of it is, if you like, in the air, if that makes sense to you. I hope it does as I'm speaking. And then you whirl it round your head rapidly, and it will make a rather strange noise that goes something like woof, woof, woof as you do it. And that is what calls the spirits. You have to be very careful that the cord is tied securely. This is a health and safety warning. And that there's no one who it might hit, because it will do them really serious injury. And the one I write about in the book, I made mine out of driftwood, collected on the seashore, and I use it at the seashore to call up spirits of the sea. It actually came from, quite unusually for me, I didn't find it on the beaches where I live. I was staying with some witch friends on the northeast coast of Scotland, and that's where I found it.
And it's described here. You can, you know, it's very interesting. And you talk about also about shells and sea glass and all of that. Mirrors. This is a very ancient, right? Reflecting pools, I mean, still water reflecting. We have a lot of things about mirrors that we transformed it into mirrors, but basically the first forms of this were actually wells or pools of water and, you know, under the night sky. And then you talk about also invoking a spirit into the mirror to divine, which is sort of make divination or to actually ask a question. You have a whole section of the book called Mirrors, Lights, and Reflections, which is absolutely incredible. It talks about, you know, the balls, the witch's balls, you know, all of that. And it's very interesting because, you know, in different places, you say here the Witche'S Well is a large silvered reflected glass sphere.
Mm.
I've seen them also, and this is very interesting. I don't know if you come across with this. I've seen them made of buoys.
Yes.
Right? From the sea.
I have one of those. I'm
you do?
Okay. I'm talking to you. when I was a child, you know, back when dinosaurs walked the earth, you still found these things. And mm-hmm. I grew up by the sea in North Wales in a place called Anglesey, and my dad used to take me for lovely long walks along the beach. Usually ended up with him carrying me, you know, at the age of, I must have been 5 or 6.
Mm-hmm.
When we found this one, a dark green glass float, and it's a great tradition in this country to use one of those as the Witche'S Ball. You know, that's a gift from the sea. Mm-hmm. I think sadly now, you know, it's so long since they were used, and they're such fragile things that I think it would be highly unlikely to find one now.
I actually sent it to one that I had two, and I sent mm. one to the Museum of Witchcraft actually, so it's from Portugal directly. But I don't know if it is there or not, but
yeah.
You know, I sent it. So very, very, very beautiful book, small book, but with precious, it's full of precious stones. It's full of little pearls of wisdom, isn't it?
And
very easy to read. It's not really very complicated at all. It really is. You know what it is? I think that and I like this. It's you know, you go into the explanations of things, and I really like the way you do it because it's almost like you're a storyteller. You tell a story, right?
Yeah.
About that, you know, the knife, for instance, and then in the process we'd learn how to do it.
That's the idea, because that's how we learn, how we learn best, I think.
Really, really interesting. It's wonderful.
Do you
have any more books, Levannah? Because we really would like to read more from you.
I have a chapter in a book that's coming out kind of about now. It's published by Freehand Press.
Mm-hmm.
In the US, so wonderful Daniel Shulker, and it's an anthology about traditional witchcraft called Hands of Apostasy.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a chapter in that which is going into a lot more detail about the use of the mirror and the tides and the two things working together, because it's my great passion.
Yes.
And I'm actually partway through writing my next book at the moment, and that is all about the sea and the tides. So it goes much deeper into those ideas than I was able to in A Witch's Mirror, alongside all the other things. So that's what I'm about at the moment.
Now, do we know the publisher of this book that you're finishing right now?
That will be Capel Ban.
Okay.
I wouldn't say it's quite finished yet, so don't expect it within the next couple of months, but it's
on
the
way. That's fine. Would you mind to come back?
I'd love to come back anytime.
Ladies and gentlemen, Levannah Morgan, A Witch's Mirror, The Art of Making Magic. Again, thank you so much, Levannah, for accepting our invitation, for being here with us, and to share your so generously your wisdom in your book and in this conversation. And also, we do want to read more things from you, so keep writing.
Well, thank you. I will. And it's been really lovely to talk with you.
Thank you so much for being on the Black Chair. I'm just going to finish the show. Levannah, don't go anywhere. I will talk to you in a bit. Okay.
All
thank
right.
you so much. Thank
do
you.
Want to, do you want to call me back or?
Yeah. No. I will. Yeah. I will talk to you in a minute.
Okay. Okay. All right then.
All right. Okay.
Bye.
Thank you so much, everyone, for being here and to listen to us. And we.